गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। वंस अगेन गुड मॉर्निंग। टुडे वी विल डिस्कस समथिंग डिफरेंट देन द नॉर्मल सिलेबस। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस सम ऑफ द एग्जांपल्स व्हिच आर रिलेटेड टू द फोर्क फंक्शन। These things which is not there in your syllabus, but these examples, these things you want to know once you have come across the fork function. And this is a common question in the competitive exams like GATE, the other exams, the NEET exam or the PGCET or any other exams. That is why we are going to discuss this fork, and if you understand this, then it will be easy to understand the examples which are there in your textbook. And this is one sample program, and this program which I am going to run in the online compiler. The online compiler is onlinegdb.com. The first example. See the three header files. This header files, it is already included in the online GDB, UniSTD, system.types, and stdio.h. stdio.h for this printf, input-output, and these two for the fork function. See now, as we all know, what is a fork? The fork is going to create a child process. A child process, but when I execute this now, how many times this printf is going to print? That is the question. Let us run the program. Okay, see, now we have run the program, but you see the output hello world two times. Why the hello world is print two times is, since you have created the child process, there is another process, that is parent process, the calling process, that is parent process and child process. There are two process, and this parent process is going to execute the entire program once, then the child program is going to execute the entire program. That is why when it has executed, when the parent process has executed fork, it has created a child and it has printed this statement hello world. Once again, the child process has executed this fork, and after that it has executed the printf statement hello world, and it has print another time. What is the order of execution? Whether the parent process will execute first or the child process will execute, that depends upon the CPU scheduling. That control will not be there in our hand. That is in the CPU scheduling, whether the child process will call first or the parent process. But this fork function is going to create a child process, and that even the parent process will completely execute this program. Once again, the child process also will execute this entire program. That is why you are able to see hello world two times. Hello world two times. The next question is, if we call the fork, first we'll see the before we call go to the increasing the number of times of fork, first we'll see the what are the IDs that is going to be created, what are the return values, how we'll see the parent IDs, all those things. See now, printf in order for the beautification. I've added one more slash in. Now you can see output, proper output. I'll remove once again the colon. That doesn't look good. Hmm. Okay, still. The return value, the process ID 6869, return value. We'll see here now. See, when I have created one more variable to store the return value of the fork function. To store the return value of the fork function, PID variable is created. I'm going to print that return value. I'm going to print the ID of the that process, the calling process, and I'm going to call the parent ID of the calling process. Parent ID of the calling process. Three different functions. These functions you have already seen: get PID, get PPID, get UID, get effective user ID, all those things. Now, you see here, when I executed this, return value is 20112. If it returns some number greater than zero, then it indicates that is the ID of the child process. That is the child process ID. If it returns greater than zero, then it is the ID of the child process. Then what this line indicates is, this is an execution of the parent process. The parent process has executed and it has returned these three printf statement. The next row, it is the child process which has executed and it has print these three values. See here, the return value 20112, that is the ID of the parent process. What about the calling process ID 20111? Calling process, the parent of that, the parent of the calling process is 20106. That we are not worried about this, because the parent process of the calling process. But when it comes to the child, when the child has executed this fork statement, the return value is zero. When the parent has executed the fork, it has given the ID of the child. When the child executed the fork function, the return value will be zero. It indicates it is not going to create one more child. Next, the child process, when it has executed, the ID is 20112. That you can match here. That you can match 20112. The parent process has returned the ID 20112. That will matches with the when the child executes get PID. What about the child parent process? Child parent process, the child parent process is 20111. See, parent process 20111, it matches with the when the child executes get PPID parent process 20111. Other than, forget this, other than this, it matches. See here, return value zero, child process ID, it will matches with the return value of the parent process. Parent process ID, it will match with the when the calling process executes get PID. I think this is clear now. Don't worry about this. The first, the pair, when the parent process executes, getting that PPID, the parent of that, grandparent of that child, we are not worried about that. Only these three, five values you have to understand. Mainly you have to understand the child process, when it executes the fork function, it returns value zero. When the parent process executes the fork function, it returns the ID of the child. That you should remember. This one. When the parent executes, it returns the child process ID. When the child process executes the fork function, it returns the value zero. Main thing, you have to remember this. Next we'll go to the another example. It might be confusing. See here. And this is a common questions that I have seen in the exams. When I call the fork function 3 times, how many times the hello is going to print? It is the problem. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. This is what the output. See, since this is an online compiler, still there is a problem you are going to face in the output. It is better to run it in the system itself, not the online compiler, but you should have these header files, sys/types.h. The total number of times it is going to execute the hello is 7 times. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I actually show with this, with the tree diagram, how many times it has to print the hello statement. With the tree diagram, I am to show. See the parent process. Once you have called the fork. Fork you have called once. Whenever you call the fork once, it will create a child process, and still there will be a parent process. There is a parent process and a child process. This parent process, once again, I have written on the right hand side. Left hand side is the first child. How many number of processes? Two processes. And if we execute two process, if it executes the printf statement, 2 times it is going to print. Now, once again, there is a fork. Fork function, when you call, see, there are two process. Now, once again, when the C1 executes, it will create another child, and there will be a parent process, that is C1. There will be a parent process C1, and one more child is C2. Is clear? Totally how many process? See, child 1, child 2, and parent process. Child 1, child 2, and the parent process. Now, how many times it is going to print the hello world? If it is 2 times. How many times it is going to print the hello world is, How many number of the child process are there, plus the parent process. You have to include that also. 2 power 2, 4 times. 2 power 2, 4 times it is going to print the hello world. How to calculate? You have to count the fork, how many times it is there, 2 raised to the number of times the fork is called. Those many times it is going to execute that program, and if there are printf statements, it is going to print. Once again, the child process. Now this is a parent. If once again the fork is called, Once again, the fork is called. This child 2 will create third child, and once again there is another process C2. Means that is a parent process. See, three times the fork is called. See the hierarchy. See, this is a parent process. This one, it is if there is a printf statement, it is going to execute the printf statement once. C3 is going to execute the printf statement. This parent process. See, forget this. Just once if it is called, once this is called, the child process and the parent process both will execute. That is why two times it is going to print. Now, once again the fork is there. Now, the child process that will create another second child. Now this is the next process. You cannot call it as now a child. It is yet another process. That will create another process. That way I am going to write it as C2. And the same parent process, instead of writing PP, I have written C1. Once again, the child 2, if I have fork, third child, the parent process. Now, you have to count the number of processes which are created. Always, the number of processes created will be, number of child processes created will be 2 power the number of times the fork minus 1. If there are three fork statements in the program, totally 7 childs are created. 2 power 3, 8 minus 1. Child process are created. How many process will be there? 7 child process plus 1, 8 child process. Understand this formula. The number of forks, if it is n, then the number of child process will be 2 power n minus 1. Example, if n equals 3 times it is fork, number of child process will be 8 minus 1, that equals 7. What about number of total process count? That will be 7, that is a child process, number of the childs, plus the parent process, that is 1, that will be totally 8. It is as simple as that. If n equals 1, then how many number of child process? The number of child process will be 2 power 1, that is 2 minus 1, that equals 1. the number of child process will be 1. What about the number of total process? Child process plus 1 parent process, that will be 2. I think this formula you should remember. Based on this itself, you can say how many times it is going to print the printf statement. Why it is 8 times? See, this is still understand. This is a problem with the compiler. Why it is giving 4 times? But actually, it should print 8 times. It's a problem with the 4. Actually, you will see that output also 8 times. This problem you are not going to face if you 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Very few times you are going to get the hello count 8. Or if you use geeks, C compiler, we'll run it here, the same program. Now we'll run here. The problem is that it requires int and return 0. That it requires this int main. For function was not declared in this scope. Is the problem. See here, we have called the fork function 2 times. What will be the output? It is 4 times. If I call the fork now 3 times, if I call the fork 3 times, what will be the output? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Why it is 8? That is because of this formula. You can understand this. The number of times the fork is called is 3. 2 power 3 minus 1. It is 8 minus 1, 7. 7 times the child process will call that. 7 times the child process will call this printf statement. And once the parent process will call this printf statement, therefore, it is 8 times it is going to print hello world. Now better you use this compiler ide.geeksfordees.org instead of online GDB. Now we'll see the another example. Just by checking with the ID itself. What we have written is, if the fork function, if it returns 0, we are restricting the statements. Instead of the program, the parent process to run the entire program and the child process to run the entire program, now we have restricted. When the parent process executes, it prints only this printf statement, not the other. When the child process runs, it runs only this if condition, not the else. Because when the parent process executes this fork, it will not return the value 0 because it returns the ID of the child process. Therefore, this printf statement, it is not going to print. It will print hello from parent. When the child process executes, the return value from the fork will be 0. In that case, it will print hello from child. It will not execute else. it will not execute else. It is as simple as that. Now we are restricting the parent process and the child process to execute the statements based on the return values. You can restrict like this. With the return values, you can restrict the statements to be executed by the parent process and the child process. I think these examples, this is what you see in the textbook. Many times you will see fork equals zero. Fork equals zero, it indicates only the child will execute the statements within that if condition. Else, only the parent process will execute these statements. Only the parent process will execute these statements. I think this is clear by this example. How to restrict the statements to be executed by the parent process and the child process. I want you to make understand one more thing is this one. The variables, whether the same copy of the variable is been given to the parent and the child or a different copies of X, the variables will be given to the parent and child. We'll try to understand this. We'll copy only this much. This is enough. And we run what the output will get. Parent is x equals 0, child is x equals 2. See, parent it is giving x equals 0, child is 2. So we'll try to understand this. See, int x equals 1, before the execution, x equals 1. Now, fork is called, if it comes to if, fork is executed. Now, the parent process has executed the fork function. Now, if it returns zero, means the child process is running. It indicates the child process is running. If the parent process is running, it will return the child process ID. Then it will not come inside the if, it will come to else. In that case, what is the parent? The parent will be minus minus x. What is minus minus x? Pre-decrement. Pre-decrement means first it will decrement, one will become zero. That is why parent as x equals zero. Parent as x equals 0. Now the child process will start running the same program. Fork, the child process will execute this fork statement. Now it will return the value 0 because the child process is running. When the child process is running, it is 0. Now the child as x equals plus plus x. First, it is going to pre-increment. Pre-increment, now the x is not zero. Now, x is not zero because since this is a separate process, since this is child is a separate process, x as a separate copy with the child process, now x equals 1. It is not going to worry what was the value of x when the parent process has executed. When the parent process has executed, what was the value? It is not going to worry. Still, the child process has a fresh copy of the x value, that x equals 1. That is why plus plus 1, it will become 2. That is why the child has x equals 2. It is not 1, it is 2. Because this x equals 1, this child process has a separate copy of x equals 1. The parent process has a separate copy of x equals 1 in the beginning when they execute. That is why this 1 will become 0 here this one will become two here. I think now this is very clear that it starts executing from here first opening bracket to close bracket, the parent and the child process, and that is one thing. And all the variables which are present inside the main function, both will have a separate copy of those variables. And how to restrict the statements, how to restrict the statements to be executed is with the return values of the fork. If it is zero, child process is executing. If it is other than zero, if it is less than one means, if it is less than zero indicates it has not properly created a child process, it is a fork error. That is why you will see the message in the textbook, it is a fork error. If it is greater than zero means some number, that some number will be the ID of the process. Whether it can be a child process or it can be the parent process. A separate copy, two copies of the variable X. Now I think this is clear. With these examples, now you can now you can understand the programs which are there in the textbook. You can directly copy those programs and run in this IDE, IDE.geeksfordeeks.org, like this. See, I think this textbook you are going to get online, and we'll go to the exactly that page 250. Any process here? We'll go to the next chapter. Process. Sorry. We'll see the index. We'll see the index weight. Process control, the fork example, 229. See the direct program. We'll check whether you can directly practice. Whether these header files. Is there any error in this? The error was not declared in this scope. Okay, these files are not there, I think. We'll make printf these things. Other than this, any other mistakes? Exit function was not declared in this scope. Okay. Exit function. The problem with the exit function. That is normal termination. Any other mistakes? We'll try to match the output. See, you can see the output. This is how you can execute the program and see the output of the programs which are there in the textbook. Two things you have to do where the exit, wherever you see the exit at the end of the program, that you have to remove. And one more is this error dot underscore system, you replace with the printf statements. can replace with the printf statements. Sleep function. See here, what was the program? Some buffer was there. Here they want to demonstrate before the fork function. See, two times it is going to call. See how many times the fork is there in this program? Only once. Only once the fork function is there. Therefore, two times it is going to execute the entire program. Two times it is going to execute the entire program. And we have restricted the execution of the means we are not executing all the statements. Therefore, there is a if conditions are there. See here, there are if conditions are there. There are three variables. The variable 88, this PID. That PID it is the return value. See here, when it executes, one program I am just explaining it here. Just in the previous classes, I have shown the program and I have shown the output. Here with the example, I am going to show you. See, write the standard output file from this buffer, to the standard output. It is simple. From this array, you have to going to write it to the console. That's all. This is a console. Instead of printf statements directly printing, what they are doing is they are doing this write function. With the write function, they are writing it to the standard output, means that console, from the buffer, not from the printf statement, from the buffer. From the buffer, that buffer is an array. That array contains this file. Now, see here, a write to standard output is once. Before fork, and this statement, it is two times. This is two times. This before fork is two times. But this one, writing this statement, this flushing the statements, a write to standard output, it is only once. Why? Because whatever it is been buffered, only once it is going to flush. It is not going to store this standard output file whenever it is been flushed. It will be directly thrown to the output. It is not stored once, and for the second time, it is not going to flush it to the output screen. It is not two times. That is why you are not going to see this statement two times. Before fork, the parent process will run once. That is why before fork is printed once. If it is less than zero, fork error, or else if it is a child, it will increment this variable. If it is parent, alt for 2 seconds, and it will print all this variable. 17320, global variables are both having a separate copies. Because when there is a parent process runs, just sleep for the second. We are not incrementing. That is why it is still 688. It is still 688. Where is another variable? Global variable. 688. When the parent process executes, we are not doing anything. It is just to sleep for 2 seconds. That is why it has print that number 688. When the parent process, when the child process has executed, we are going to increment those two. That is why those two numbers has been incremented, 7 and 89. When the ID we print, parent ID 72330, the parent process ID will be 17321. The return value, if you check, that will be 0. This is a straightforward example. In the same way, you can copy all the programs and you can execute and you can see the output. In the next class, we will discuss the race conditions. And if you face any problem in executing the programs, please feel to ask it in the group or individually. For today's class, it is enough. Thank you.